Let's sing together tonight, He Keeps Me Singing. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of us ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, swung upon the chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Singing as I go, feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath His sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Well, good evening. Welcome back to our evening service. Let me give you just a few announcements as reminders. Don't forget deacons. Our deacons meeting will be next Sunday evening at 5 o'clock. And there was something I meant to announce this morning, and it slipped by me. And that is Joy Group will be meeting this Tuesday at, we'll be leaving the church at 8:15, headed over to Cracker Barrel. So Joy Group, just keep that in mind, and see you Tuesday. Ladies Day Out, the Northeast District Act Women Active for Christ meeting will be Saturday, March the 4th at the Amory Free Will Baptist Church, and the ladies will be leaving the church at 8:45 that morning. And then lastly, don't forget, ladies, that those of you that are in the Inside Out, be meeting after service down in the Family Life Center in the kitchen, and Miss Lisa will be serving you tonight. So keep that in mind as well. All right, let's have our ushers come forward. We'll receive our evening offering. Let's pray. Father, we thank You so much for this day. We thank You for the service this morning. Lord, we thank You so much for, again, Lord, what all that You are doing here at Fulton Free Will Baptist Church. Lord, may it be all for Your glory. We thank You now for this time that we have. We just pray Your blessings on our service tonight. We pray Your blessings now on the offering. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen.
Sing the praise hymn, We Will Glorify the King of Kings.
We will glorify the King.
righteousness, we will worship Him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to Him we give. Hallelujah to the King of kings. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of lords, who is the great I am.
If you have your Bibles, you can be turning with me to the book of Daniel. Book of Daniel. We will get to Daniel here in just a little bit. So I want to start off with tonight, because tonight's going to start us off on probably a little journey. So I want to start us off with a few questions. And that is, can God give humanity insight into the future? And I think we would all agree with that He can. Then the next question, of course, would be, does He give humanity insight into the future? And the answer, of course, is yes. He's given us His Word, and His Word reveals to us things that will come and things that must come to pass. And then third would be, can God judge nations for their wickedness? And of course, the answer to that is also yes, because He is God, He is the Creator, He is holy, He is righteous, He is just, He is what we call the just judge, and He has every right to judge nations because of their wickedness, and we see that. So tonight we begin what will probably again be a lengthy trip into Bible prophecy on Sunday nights. We're going to begin tonight in Daniel, and we're going to work our way through Daniel. And then after Daniel, however long Daniel takes, we'll probably dive into Jesus' teaching on future events there in Matthew 24, 25. And then after Matthew, we'll probably dive into the book of Revelation. So, Lord willing. And so Sunday nights are going to be kind of, that's where we're going to kind of be parked for a little while. And so I want to kind of give you a heads up on that. So tonight we begin the book of Daniel. Now Daniel, it's not all about prophecy in the book of Daniel, but the majority of it is. Now, a major theme that we will see in the book of Daniel, as we just kind of just put this into your mind, is the fact of God's, what we call God's sovereignty. Now the sovereignty of God is just simply the fact that God rules and reigns over His creation. There's really no debate on that one. But what is debated among believers is about how much sovereignty does God apply to the will of man and over the will of man. That is debated. Whether you're what we would call the Calvinist side of things or the Arminian side of things, depending on how you look at those two things, on which side you fall. We Free Will Baptists fall on the Arminian side of things, but we all will agree that we believe in the sovereignty of God, that He rules and reigns over His creation. So the reason I bring that up is when we get to Daniel, that is a theme in Daniel. There's just no question about it. We see Him using nations as He sees fit, and we will see here shortly that He uses a nation to judge another nation. And so so the God's sovereignty is in play. Now, before we dive into Daniel chapter 1, and we're only going to look at the first two verses tonight. So we're not going to be moving at a rapid pace, just the first two verses tonight. I want to give a little bit of a background to kind of bring us up to the book of Daniel. Now, we're not going to go all the way back to Adam, but I just want to kind of start bring us up to speed as to where we are when we come to the book of Daniel. Because, you know, unless you're a person who likes history and you like prophecy and you like all those things, not a lot of people are going to sit down and do all that kind of thing. And that's okay. I think we should because it's important. But I understand that that's probably not on people's high priority list as they sit down to do their devotions every day. So I hope you'll give me a little bit of liberty to give us a little bit of background for it. So the first thing, just kind of start at a starting point, I started with Deuteronomy 28. And the reason for that is, in Deuteronomy 28, we see God, Israel's into the promised land. Remember, they've come out of Egypt. They're now in the promised land and all those sorts of things. And God makes a covenant with Israel. And it's a type of covenant that he makes that he says, if you do this, then I will do this. And basically the idea is in Deuteronomy 28 verses 1 through 14, you have God telling Israel, listen, if you will obey me, if you will live for me, if you will love me, if you'll just be what I've wanted you to be, then I will bless your socks off. And then in verses 15 through 68, the rest of the chapter of Deuteronomy 28, he looks at them and says, but listen, if you don't obey me, these are the consequences. Okay, so that's kind of where we are. And just to give you an idea, and let me tell you this up front. Get your Bibles ready because we have a ton of scripture that we have to look at to kind of bring us up to speed up to the book of Daniel. So Deuteronomy 28, let me just read the first four verses of Deuteronomy 28. It says, and this is the Lord speaking, and if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all that he commands that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground and in the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your herds and the young of your flock. And if you just stop there, and that's just the first four verses, and you got to go all the way to 14 to get to the end of it. He just says, listen, I want to do such great things for you and in you and through you, but I need you to obey, right? So that's kind of where we start. Now, when you think about Israel, they don't have a great track record, right? They just don't. Now, for the history that I'm going to kind of give us tonight, there's several sources I was looking into and checking with because I wanted to make sure that I was right on some of these things. So because my memory just isn't probably what it used to be. And so I'm relying on several different things to make sure we get it correct and in order. Now, what I do want us to know is that there were times that Israel was faithful to the Lord. It's not like they were completely disobedient all the time. They had moments. But the overall reality is that when you look at Israel's history, they were kind of in a downward spiral of depravity and disobedience to the Lord. And they were under the Lord's discipline a whole lot. And so, for example, in Judges 21:25, it tells us that in those days there was no king in Israel. And one of the saddest statements that we see is that it says everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And if that's not a description of our own culture, I don't know what is. That everyone just does what is right in his or her own eyes. Now, during the reign of King David, Israel had some good moments. They were faithful for the most part. David had moments of faithfulness, but we also know that David had moments of unfaithfulness. But when you look back on history and when scriptures look back to David, they tell us that David was a man after God's own heart, that he was a servant of God. And Solomon's son, or David's son Solomon, he was faithful, but later on in his life, he left the Lord. And I want us to take a look at that. In 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Listen to what happens. It says, now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women, from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel. Now listen, the Lord said this, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. But then it says, Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives who were princesses and 300 concubines. There's been so many jokes made of that, there's just no sense in even going there, right? So he says, for when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God, and was the heart of David as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. So Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and did not wholly follow the Lord, again, as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, or Shamash, the abomination of Moab, and for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites, on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrifice to their gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he did not keep what the Lord commanded. Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, since this has been your practice and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes that I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. So following what happens is that following Solomon's death, the Lord, in an act of judgment, divides Israel into two parts. He divides the one part into 10 northern tribes. Remember the 12 tribes of Israel as we think about in Genesis? So you have the 10 tribes, the 10 northern tribes, and two southern tribes. So if you looked at a map, you had Israel on the top, and that represented 10 tribes, and you had Judah on the bottom representing two tribes. Israel was then led by a wicked king by the name of Jeroboam the First. Now listen to what Jeroboam did in 1 Kings chapter 12. He says, then Jeroboam built Shechem in the hill country of Ephraim and lived there, and he went out from there and built Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now listen, this is the king of Israel. He says, now the kingdom will turn back to the house of David if this people go up to offer sacrifices in the temple of the Lord at Jerusalem. Then the heart of this people will turn again to their Lord, to Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they will kill me and return to Rehoboam, the king of Judah. So the king took counsel and made two calves of gold. And he said to the people, you have gone up to Jerusalem long enough. Behold, now catch this, behold your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. And he set one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. Then this thing became a sin, for the people went as far as Dan to be before one. So the idea was simply this: he felt threatened that he would be taken off the throne. So he builds two golden calves. He puts one at the north part of Israel and one at the south part of Israel, so that they could travel either way to get to it. And the crazy thing is, they bought it. Now think about that. Did they not learn the lesson in the desert? And yet, they just, when you read the account, it's just like they went, that is such a good idea. Why didn't we think of that? It's so pretty and shiny and gold. Now, for Judah, so that's the northern part. For Judah in the south, what they did, they continued the lineage of David for its kings. Okay, so you had other kings in the north and that came, and then you had kings in the south. Now, the northern kingdom, this Israel, kept rebelling. And in 722 BC, God used the Assyrians to bring judgment on Israel. Now remember, what we're coming to is in Daniel chapter 1. Because when we get to Daniel chapter 1, we're going to be at 605 BC. So right now we're looking at Israel and it's 722. And the northern tribe is fallen. And Isaiah told them in Isaiah chapter 10 verses 5 and 6. He said, "Woe to Assyria, the rod of my anger." This is the Lord speaking. "The staff in their hands is my fury. Against a godless nation I send him, and against the people of my wrath I command him to take spoil and seize plunder and to tread them down like the mire in the streets." So God sent in the Assyrians to judge the people of Israel because of their sin. And Isaiah told them it was coming. And they ignored it. And so in 722, it happened. And it virtually wiped out the northern 10 tribes. In Judah, sadly, they didn't learn from Israel. They too began to sin against the Lord. And Judah in the south had many warnings as well from Isaiah, from Jeremiah, from Habakkuk, from Zephaniah. All these prophets kept telling them, listen, judgment is going to come unless you repent. Habakkuk 1:12. Isaiah 39, Habakkuk's later. Isaiah 39, 6 and 7 says, "Behold, the days are coming when all that is in your house and that which your fathers have stored up till this day shall be carried to Babylon. Nothing shall be left, says the Lord. And some of your own sons who will come from you, whom you will father, shall be taken away, and they shall be eunuchs in the place of the king of Babylon." So Isaiah, before it ever happens, prophesies and tells them, listen, judgment's coming, and you're going to go into captivity into a land called Babylon. And Judah ignored it. They ignored the warnings. Now this brings us to Daniel. It has been 117 years since Israel fell to the Assyrians. Now the time for Judah's judgment has come, and it is now 605 BC. So we pick up in Daniel chapter 1. He says, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God." So Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians invade Jerusalem and it falls. Now, to give us an idea of what that would be like, I tried to think of a scenario. So here was my scenario. It would be as if ISIS came from Syria and attacked the United States and Washington, D.C. fell to ISIS. Now think about what that would mean for us, right? What would happen if ISIS took us captive? Not only did they take us captive, but then they haul us back across the ocean to Syria, to where what we will see is that we would have to spend the next 70 years in a place called Syria as captives. This is what happens to Judah. They rebel against God. They sin against God. They ignore the warnings from God. They ignore the prophets of God. And finally, after warning and warning and warning, in 605 BC, God says it is time for judgment. And so Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians, who, by the way, was one of the most evil, wicked, godless nation on the earth. So God used them, which is an interesting thought. And we kind of looked at that this past Wednesday a little bit. So Nebuchadnezzar takes the people back to Babylon, and he does it in three stages. The first stage is in 605 BC. This is when Daniel is taken. There's a second deportation that takes place in 597 BC. And this would include the prophet Ezekiel. So he is taken over to Babylon. And then the final deportation that takes place happens in 586 BC. And what we see is that God used Babylon to judge Judah just as he used Assyria to judge Israel. Habakkuk 1:12 says this, "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God, my Holy One?" Now catch this. He says, "We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them." The "them" would be Babylon. "You have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O rock, have established them for reproof." So let's look at Judah's sins and their captivity that they would be going into, because that's what these verses tell us is happening. God said that they would be there for 70 years. Now, why did God say 70 years? Did he just pull that one out of thin air? Was it like, hey, that's a good number. Seven, completion, right? No, that's not it. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, and there's a passage in Jeremiah as well, but 2 Chronicles 36 verses 20 and 21 tell us this. "He took into exile in Babylon those who had escaped from the sword, and they became servants to him and to his sons until the establishment of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed its Sabbaths. All the days that it lay desolate, it kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years. So here's what that means. God told the children of Israel that when you go into the land of promise, the promised land, when you remember they came out of Egypt, was in the wilderness, and then God says, "I'm getting ready to take you into the promised land." Remember Joshua chapter 1, go into the promised land. Chapter 3, and all that good stuff, right? So he says, when you get into the promised land, I'm going to lay out some rules for your farming. And it's this: you work the land for 6 years, and on that seventh year, you let the land rest, right? Don't plant, just let it rest. And what happens is that Israel fails to do that for 490 years. They ignore what God told them to do. They just kept plowing away. So they ignored this part of the Sabbath. So what happens is God would reclaim the land by having them in captivity for 70 years because they missed 70 Sabbaths. So he says, "You're going to go into captivity for 70 years, because I'm getting my land back." Now remember Deuteronomy 28, right? "Do this, I'll bless you. Disobey, there's consequences." And they disobeyed. I like one writer, he put it this way. He said, "If Israel would not give God the Sabbath he required, then he would take it from them by means of captivity." Now, before we're too harsh on Israel, now when I say Israel, I just mean the Jewish people as a whole, because that's just, it comes out that way. Before we're too harsh on the Jewish people, just from a nation perspective for a moment, has God not poured out so much blessing on our own nation? And to be as young of a nation as we are, remember, we're not that old. And yet in the midst of God's blessing, since the 1960s, we have decided that we just simply don't need God anymore. So we're really not that different from what they were. We've kind of begun that same process. We've begun to go down that same path that they did. And let me just say this. May we have, quote unquote, prophets in the land, and I don't mean that literally. I just simply mean it in this term. May we in America have some people, some preachers, who gets a spine and is willing to stand up and to preach the whole counsel of God and preach the gospel and tell people you have to repent and that we as a nation need to repent because we are no better than any other nation that's ever existed. And God is just as holy today as he was in 605 BC when he decided to take Israel or to take Judah into captivity. So the sin number one for Judah was that they did not observe the Sabbath. The second sin was Judah's idolatry, just the fact that they served false gods. Now, we see in verses 1 and 2 by a king by the name of Jehoiakim. Now, when Jerusalem fell in 605 BC, he was the king. And can I just tell you that he was really one of the wicked kings that they had? For example, in Jeremiah 36:23, it says this, as Jehudi read three or four columns, the king would cut off with a knife and throw them into the fire in the fire pot until the entire scroll was consumed in the fire that was in the fire pot. Now, what that means is this. You got to go back to the previous verses. We got to start like verse 1, but I didn't want to do that. But what happened is a word of the Lord came and said, read this to him. So virtually what we have is it's God's word being read to Jehoiakim. And when he hears God's word, instead of obeying God's word, he takes God's word and he cuts it and he throws it in the fire. Can you imagine? Can you imagine if we took this book that we hold so dear, and as we read it, someone decided to just start slicing it and throwing it until it burns up. What it tells us is that Jehoiakim was an evil man, and he did not want to listen to what God had to say. Now, let's look at verse 2 real quick. The second part there, it says, well, let's read the whole thing. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, the king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. I'm just going to read a quote from David Jeremiah concerning this part of the verse because I think he summarizes it well. He says, quote, Nebuchadnezzar's confiscation of these holy items was a gesture of religious dominance meant to demonstrate to the conquered Judeans that their God, the true living God, was too weak to save them from defeat. And in that day, to conquer a nation was also to conquer its gods. So when Judah fell and those things that were in the house of God were taken and then they were taken to the place in Babylon with Marduk and all those false gods that they served and they placed God's things in the false God's house, it looked at Judah and said, your God is worthless. Your God does nothing. This is where Judah was. So what does it mean for us? What's some application for us? A few things I want us to take away. Number one, the fact that God is sovereign. And I take great comfort in that. Because listen, God knew that when Babylon took Judah, he knew that they would also take the items back to Babylon. And he knew what that would signify. But he had greater purposes, and he accomplished them. Not only that, but please listen, and it comes back to what we hit on a little bit this morning, and that is the fact that God takes sin seriously. Way more serious than we probably do, if we're just being honest. Way more serious than we do. We sometimes kind of sweep it under the rug. Well, it wasn't that bad. A good reminder for us also is the fact that God will not be mocked. Israel would not mock God without judgment. Judah would not mock God without judgment. And the reality is the world will not mock God without judgment. It also brings to our attention the fact that God will judge sin. He always does. And he always will. Why? Because he's the just judge. He's holy. And the last one is this. I love this because this gets us into that mindset of prophecy that we'll see as we go through the book of Daniel. And that is that God fulfills his word. The fall of Judah was prophesied, and the prophecies were fulfilled exactly as God said they would be. Exactly as he said they would be. Real quick, and then we're going to be done. When you think about Jesus, I mean, think about this, that in the Old Testament there were over 300 prophecies that were given about Jesus, about his first coming, right? Over 300. And every single one of them was fulfilled to a T, perfectly. It's because God is sovereign. And God's going to fulfill his word. So, tonight begins our journey through the book of Daniel. I want us to take comfort in that last one, that God fulfills his word. Always. So when we read the promises of God that truly apply to believers, that apply to his kids, you can count on those. When we read about what eternity is going to be like, and whether it's in Revelation or in other places, because there's other places in Scripture that gives us these little tidbits about what it's going to be like. It's going to be that and so much more. Because man was trying to, I mean, think about this. They're trying to put on paper the things that they have seen. And I'm just not sure human language can truly express the beauty that heaven will be. God fulfills his word. Hold on to that. Because we live in a very shaky world, a world of uncertainty, a world that is constantly changing. And the great thing is that we as believers have a word that will not change, and yet it will be fulfilled. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for tonight, and we thank you for your word. And Lord, it's been some time coming as we begin to look into the book of Daniel. Lord, we thank you so much for who you are. Thank you that you are the creator, the sustainer. Father, I thank you that we can trust your word, that you have seen fit to make sure that we have your word written down for us. Lord, may we truly hold your word high. May we put it in our hearts and in our minds. And Lord, may we live by it. Forgive us, Lord, when we fail. Convict us, I pray. Help us to mourn. Help us to repent. And thank you, Lord, for that promise of comfort and joy when we do. Lord, there's many people on our hearts tonight, those who have had surgeries and sickness, and some who just may be going through some difficult times. May they find comfort in your word. May they find truth in your word. Lord, I pray as we get ready to leave, Lord, that you'd watch over us this week. Help us to be salt and light. Help us to honor you with all that we do. And we pray it in Christ's name. Amen.